Good morning and welcome to the Awesomeness of God Christian Church. On this morning, we're going to spend some time going back to the basics here for the next few weeks. I think oftentimes we assume that people know something, or we assume that the people in the body of Christ are aware of simple things. And oftentimes in life, we have to go back to the basics. And we can't assume that people have an idea or knowing of something. So this morning, we're going to talk about something that probably many would feel like in the body of Christ is simple and people know a lot about. But I do want to make sure that we are available and aware of faith. And so this morning, I want to spend some time speaking from the context of where is your faith? And so the first question we have to answer when we say, where is your faith, is we have to define what faith is. And the dictionary defines faith as complete trust, confidence, or firm trust, especially in religion or beliefs. And that is a good definition. But as Christians, I hope we go to the Word of God. And the Word of God defines faith as this in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So in its simplest form, faith is the opposite of doubt. In its simplest form. But when we read Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, there are two critical aspects that the biblical definition of faith should really cause Christians to draw their attention to. If we read, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and evidence of things not seen, we must know two things. This definition says things that are promised for the future. That's the first thing it says. The second thing it says is things are present that are invisible. So when we say now faith is a thing hoped for, that's something that we have not seen yet. It has not come to fruition. And then it says, comma, the evidence of things not seen. Now it says not seen. It doesn't say they don't exist.
Come on now.
And so us in the body of Christ have to understand that when we talk about faith, we have to be a little different than the world, because we have to understand and know that our faith is in God, who we can say we have not seen.
Come on now.
However, we know that he exists. And based on the definition of Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, it's evident that something can be seen with the naked eye, then it can no longer be faith. Uh-oh. So if you can see it with the naked eye, does not require any faith. So no different than I'm standing here. If someone asks you, is Damon standing in front of you? You don't need any faith to say yes, because you see me. However, if someone said, is Damon's heart with you? You don't know that, so it requires you to exercise a bit of faith, because you don't know if my heart is with you or against you. So that's the difference between faith and when we start talking about this thing about believing in something. So the people in the body of Christ, we have to know that there is a difference. Now, the fundamental of faith itself has to do with things that cannot be seen. So we already know they cannot be seen, but the presence is working in a supernatural realm. And so one of the key things that the body of Christ needs to understand is, when we talk about faith, is that it cannot fail. And the reason faith cannot fail has nothing to do with us. But the reason faith cannot fail is because of the fact of the person and who we're putting faith in cannot fail. So when someone says, my faith let me down, the key thing they're saying is my faith let me down, not that faith let me down. Because faith is in God, and God can do anything but fail. But oftentimes when we think of faith and someone says, well, my faith failed me or faith let me down, understand that it, well, you're right, it was your faith, but not God, because God cannot fail. So if you put your faith in God, understand faith in God cannot fail. It's a foregone conclusion. The other thing we got to talk about when we start thinking about what is faith, faith has the ability to transform people's lives from the inside out. And so we have seen people that exercise and operate their faith in God be changed people. And understand that, having said that, it comes down to when we talk about love and joy and peace and strength and confidence and so on, there is a strong bond, and we know that exists in the things, in the kinds of faith. And as a person's faith grows, what you will also notice in the body of Christ, as their faith grows, you will see their love grow, their peace grow, their joy grow. And the inverse is true. When a person's faith is waning, usually they have problems with loving. They have problems with peace. They have problems with joy. They have problems with security. And understand that the reason that is because they go hand in hand. When you start to grow and you start to exercise your faith, the more you do it, the more you become more like God. And so as you become more and more faithful, and you stand more and more on faith, and you believe in God, you start to see a change in the joy in your life. You start to see change in peace in your life. You start to see a change in your security and who you are and what you're doing. But as you start to fall back, then we start to see we are less secure about ourselves. It's harder to love. The joy that we once had kind of goes away. And these things are tied together in the body of Christ, and God ties those things together with our faith. So as our faith grows, the things of God grow. As we move off of our faith and rely more on our belief, then understand God is no longer involved in that. And so now you're operating not on faith, but on your belief. And so God is not a God that operates on that. So you're outside of God's operating system. Now, the other thing that we want to answer this morning, now that we know what faith is, world's definition and the way God views faith, we have to ask ourselves the question, is faith and belief the same thing? And I think if we don't know that now, based on what we just talked about, let's make it even clearer. The answer to that question is, and oftentimes we confuse it, people confuse faith with belief and vice versa. And they believe, they'll say, well, I believe, or they say faith, and they kind of use those words interchangeable, but those words are different. But here's the thing, at the same time, they work hand in hand. And so belief is the acceptance that a statement is true or that something exists. The second definition in Webster says, trust, faith, or confidence in someone or something. Understand that when you read that second definition, faith is in the definition of belief. What you will find if you look up the definition, and we talked about the definition of faith, you understand that the two don't necessarily go together, and here's why. There are three kinds of Christians that you'll run across in the body of Christ. You have the Christian where they're the ones where their faith and their belief in Jesus Christ, they have them both equally at the same time. Then you'll run into those in the body of Christ that they have faith, but they have no belief. And so I'll give you an example of faith and no belief. One who has faith but no belief. Because we said belief is something that's something that you know exists. So I don't play the lottery. But if I did play the lottery, if I told you I believe, or I couldn't tell you I believe that because I don't play. But if I said I have faith that I am going to win the lottery, and I told you I don't play, I never played, so I could have faith that I'm going to win the lottery one day. But obviously, I could have no belief in that because I don't play it. So I could have faith all day. But if I never do anything with it, I'm telling you, I really don't believe what I just told you, because I don't do anything about it. Now, the last kind of person you'll meet in the body of Christ are those who they have belief, but they don't have faith. And so You can have faith in Jesus Christ, but not believe him as your Lord and Savior. So I'm going to, you know, some people might say, well, that's a little confusing. I don't understand it. How can that be? We're going to read in the book of Isaiah, and I'm going to give you a clear example of someone who believes in Jesus Christ. They believe in Jesus Christ. However, they don't have any faith in him. Go to the book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 14. And we're going to see someone who believes in God, but they have no faith in him. Isaiah chapter 14, we'll start at verse 12. It says this, and listen who God is speaking to here. It says, how you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, you who weaken the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the furthest side of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. So when we read that scripture, it's obvious that Satan believes and knows that God is the I Am. That's who he aspires to be. That's who he wants to be. So he believes that there is a God. He understands that he believes that. And he understands that God is the most powerful. He understands that he's the creator. But he does not have faith in him. That is the reason he is fighting God to make himself God and exalt himself above the stars of God. A Christian must have great faith and deep belief in Jesus Christ. You have to have faith, but you also have to have belief. And so what we'll oftentimes find is a lot of people have faith in God. There's a lot of people that don't believe in that totally don't believe in God, but there are a lot more people that believe in God, or I should say, they don't believe in God, but they have faith in God. Mm-hmm. And they've never seen God. They've never been involved, but they will believe. And I mean, they have faith that there is a God. So when they pray, and they have faith that God is answering their prayers. But now if you ask them, do you believe in God? That's where the conversation changes, because if you believe in God, you would ask for things and just wait and expect them to be done. Oftentimes in the body of Christ, we don't struggle with having faith in God. We struggle with believing in God. So we will pray, and right after we're finished praying, we will go fix our own problems or try to. Because we have no belief in God, we merely have faith in him. Now, I'm not telling you faith is not important. We're going to understand and know before we leave for the day, faith is a fundamental requirement.
Come on now.
However, if you just merely have faith, but you don't believe, the relationship with God isn't connected correctly. There is a missing piece. So, a true Christian got to have great faith, but you also have to have a deep belief in God.
Amen.
As our faith in God grows, our belief deepens. As our faith in God decreases, our belief in him decreases as well.
Directly related. Come on now.
So while faith and belief are different, they work in concert together. Belief depends on a person's faith. So you don't need much faith if someone asks you, is Damon standing in front of you? Doesn't require a whole lot of faith, does it? However, you would have to exercise great faith if I ask you about something about Damon that you cannot see. So we have to understand that belief depends on faith. Faith doesn't depend on belief.
Uh-oh. Come on, Dave. Teach that.
They don't work the opposite way. In order to believe, you have to have some measure of faith. Because even if I tell you 2 + 2 = 4, you know that to be true. You've been taught that's true. You know that's true. But still, it requires some faith, maybe a small amount, because you know that to be true. But if I said Are you going to live to see tomorrow? You can't believe that because you have not seen tomorrow. And we know that you don't know tomorrow. Quite honestly, we don't know the next minute. So it would require a little more faith to step out and make an assured decision or response that, yes, I will be here tomorrow. Because you're now going to have to exercise a greater level of faith. Now, if I ask you the question, are you going to live to see tomorrow if you never leave your house? You still would have to exercise a measure of faith. But now you have made it a little easier to guarantee that you see tomorrow because you have now started to eliminate those things that could change or alter that. So we're going to always be working with some measure of faith, even when we believe, because we know, because we've been living long enough to know, truly, there's only one guaranteed, no question about thing. Anything else that we're involved in, there's some question. Now, whether you have to use great faith or small faith, you're going to have to exercise some measure of faith because you are depending on man. Just the way God set it up. So now that we understand and we know that there's a difference between faith and a difference between belief, we have to ask ourselves a question, what is the source of faith? What is the source of it? And we can find that in the book of Romans. Go to Romans chapter 10. And it answers, I love the way the Word of God answers all of our questions. And then the questions he says that he does not answer for us, he says he would set an order when he comes, or you could maybe tap in and lean on the Holy Spirit and he would speak to you there.
Thank you, Lord.
So we're going to go to the book of Romans chapter 10, verse 17, and here's what it says. You say, well, what's the source of faith? Where does it come from? Verse 17 tells us, it says, so then faith come by hearing, and hearing the word of God. The source of faith is God. He is the source of our faith, but more importantly, as Christians, we must understand that when we start talking about faith, faith comes from hearing the word of God. So, what does that mean? Christians must realize that the word is an integral part of your faith because it teaches us what and how to properly exercise faith in God. Go to James chapter 1, verse 6. See what it says there. It says something very interesting there. James chapter 1, verse 6. We have to be in our word. We have to be in the word. And I know people don't like reading. They don't like listening to. They don't like spending time in the word. But then the Bible tells us quite clearly, we just read it, that if you are struggling to do that, then if you're spending no time or little time in the word, you're going to understand that it's going to be hard to have faith in God. It's really hard to do it. So James chapter 1 verse 6 says this. It says this in James chapter 1. It says, but let him ask in faith with no doubting.
Come on now.
For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. So it says, ask in faith without doubting. And he says, so that's where that belief comes in. See, so it's many people that are making requests to God. But the part they missed was that comma, where it says, with no doubting, comma.
Oh, yeah.
And so that little with no doubting is the part where people struggle. Because what that without doubting means is, but let him ask in faith. And you could say, and believe. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven to and from. If you are praying to God, and you say, God, I believe in by faith that my life going to be changed, my house is going to be changed, my job is going to be changed. And right when I finish, I stop praying, I go trying to mess with it. I'm going to fix it. I got it, God. I'm going to make this work. What you're doing is you're being tossed to and from. One day you feel like you worked it out pretty good. The next day you say, man, all that stuff I did was for naught. I don't see any benefits. I don't see any, because you're not believing in God. You have faith in God, but you're believing in you. And so God doesn't work that way.
No, he does not.
If you can have faith in him and you pray to God, you ask for something, but then you still believe that you can fix it, God is, he's awesome. Because he'll let you go.
Come on now.
He'll take his hands off. And until you leave it alone, he's not going to touch you. That's what I like about God is never going to interrupt you. He will let you. If you want to work yourself to death, he'll let you go. And then finally, when you say, God, I can't do it anymore. I just can't. That's when he'll fit. That's when he'll
step in. Come on now. Let's go.
But he's not going to fight you. He's not going to, unlike us, you know, it's kind of like when you're a parent and you have children. At some point, you have to let children go. But oftentimes, as parents, we almost want to fight and try to take over, and we get into this battle with the kid. The kid telling you no, and you saying, well, I'm gonna step in, I'm gonna fix it for you. Well, you can do that, but I'm gonna tell you, it's outside the will of God, because at some point you have to let people learn through experience sometimes, and God will let you learn through experience. It's many people end up going crazy almost in the hospital, sick because they trying to do it. They don't believe in God, so they just worry themselves to death. They're trying to fix it. Boom, I'm running around. I've got to have my hands in this. I'm busy. I'm ripping and running. I'm doing all these things. And they're praying to God. And then you ask them, they say, well, will you pray for me? I'm praying. I don't understand why nothing's going on. Are you believing? Because you might have faith, but you got no belief. So then at that point, I don't care if I pray for you. I don't care if you get your priest praying for you. You don't believe. So God at that point, he kind of takes his hands off. Because he's not going to fight you. He's not going to be in a competition with you. And oftentimes we think, you know, we almost competing with God. Like we got a better way to fix it sometime. Or we don't think he's moving fast enough. He ain't competing with us. Now, we'll compete with each other. But man, we'll compete. You got a mother and a father and the kid needs something. It's almost, we might not even be in agreement on whether we should get it for the kid or not get it for the kid. But then we almost end up competing against each other. See who can make it happen first. God don't work that way. You want to handle it, he moves out of your way. Then right when you let it go, he'll say, okay, now I'm available. And I'm able to work for you now. Now, so the word of God is the very fuel that prepares our faith. If you're not in your word, and so I know people say, well, I don't understand why do I need to, I don't know about going to that church. I don't know why I need to hear the word of God. I don't know why I need a preacher. I don't know why I need to study this word of God. You have to do it. Because the word said, we just read it, that it fuels your faith. Fuels it. So if the only time you open in your Bible is on Sunday, or the only time you take any time to even think about God is on Sunday, your faith is going to be reduced to a 1 day, 2 hour faith walk. Because that's all you're fueling. It would be no different that if I take my car and I have to commute 20 miles a day, but I only put a quarter tank of gas in and think it's going to last me for 5 weeks, for the week. Chances are, if I put a quarter tank of gas in the car and I got to commute 20 miles each way for 5 days, I'm probably going to run out.
Come on, D.
But we are doing that in the body of Christ. So we say, I'm going to open my Bible on Sunday for 2 hours or an hour and a half, and I'm done. All right. So then we want to pray to God and ask for these big things. Mm-hmm. I'm believing God to change this. I'm believing God to do. And so that's good. But you see, one, you got little faith.
Come on now.
And your belief, because we talked about faith and belief kind of go hand in hand. So your faith, you ain't got much faith, and your belief is really weak. So at the point it don't happen, you almost the next thing that's stopping is, you know what I'm gonna do? That 2 hours is too much. So I'm going to put the 2 hours back. I'm going to zero. And then we know when you go, your faith go to zero, your belief also got to go to zero. That's the way the equation works. But that's oftentimes the body of Christ that what happens. We put a little bit of faith in and we say, okay, well, God, I'm going to read my word. And or we say, well, I'm going to read one scripture and then that's going to do it. I'm going to read one scripture for the day and then I got to move on, God. It's 24 hours in a day. It's 24 hours in a day. And you got to understand that you have an enemy that's working against you in 24 hours.
Got that right. Amen.
So if all you're doing is putting one scripture, your one little psalm scripture, and that you asking that to fuel you for 7 days and you in a battle, somebody fighting you 24 hours a day? I ain't saying you can't win the battle, but I'm saying when things get tough, you ain't got much fuel. You ain't leaning on much. And so it's very easy to see people in the body of Christ give up. Because it ain't because they bad people. It's not because they're not smart people. It's because they're not spending any time with, they ain't getting any fuel. You got to read this word, and you got to use the word to fuel you. And so when you in this word, that's why it said faith come by hearing, and hearing the word of God.
The word of God.
So you got to, when we know this, the word of God is the Bible.
Come on now.
So if faith come by hearing, and we say hearing, and we talk about reading too, but I do think it's something interesting in hearing. Hearing is, I'm going to tell you why I think that's interesting. In the Bible, it says faith come by hearing the word of God. It didn't say reading the word of God. Because I'm going to tell you, I don't care how much you read something. Why is it so easy? We can catch, if you hear a song one time, you can remember the words. If you hear it. You might read something, and I can't memorize stuff I read. But if I hear it in a song, my brain attaches to it easier. And so I think oftentimes, why is it important that we come to church? Why do we need a preacher? Because you need someone to speak the word so you can hear it.
Come on, D. Preach.
And so when you're hearing the word now, the way God made us, that activates us easier. We're able now to intake it, able to remember it. And so it says faith come by hearing, hearing the word of God.
Hearing and hearing.
So
come on now.
And I'm guilty of this too. But then that means, what are we listening to oftentimes? Mm-hmm. I'm guilty of it too. I spend more time probably listening to the news, sports, music, but I ain't listening to the word of God. And so just like I'm saying, reading this word of God, you got to be in this word. You got to be, when you in a world that's constantly talking about death, murder, rape, and that's all, you constantly hearing it. That's constantly on your mind. You got to offset that with listening to something that's counter to that.
Yes, you do.
I need to hear something about some faith, some hope, some love, some joy, some peace, some salvation, some repentance. So restoration.
Yes.
If I don't hear something about that, I'm constantly bombarded by rape, mm-hmm. murder, greed. That's all I'm hearing. And so it almost, once again, that's an easy way for the enemy to start to attack. Well, you know, that word of God always talking about giving, it's talking about love, but everything I'm hearing on the news don't seem like it line up with that. So what you start to do is it starts to eat away or erode your faith. And so that's why the Bible says faith come by hearing and hearing the word of God. We have to make sure that we are in this word and listening to the word of God. It's very important.
Daily, come on now.
The word of God is a mere portrayal of whom God is along with how he operates. So if you say, well, why do I need to read this word? Why do I need to listen to the word of God? Because this word of God tells you how he operates. It tells you how you are to operate. And so by reading the word of God, we learn about him. We learn about his ways. We learn about his will for us, as well as what he's promised and we're going to inherit. So then, as I start to read this word and I start to be more in this word, I start to understand that I am above and not beneath.
Come on now.
I am the head and not the tail.
Yes.
But I'm in this word and the word is telling me that. So then at that point, if I'm reading this, I'm listening to that, vice listening to everything the world tells me I'm not. I'm a statistic. I'm going to die early. So then you start to counteract those things. And then I start to put my faith in God, vice this world. And so that's why it's important that we understand that the source of faith is God. And we're in a world now, if you look at what's going on in the world is trying all it can. It's bombarding you with things that will destroy a person's faith. They are attacking. They are trying to erode your belief in God.
Yeah.
Well, they ain't trying to erode your belief in God merely so you can go to hell, but also you can be hell your whole time here on this place called Earth because you have no faith in anything.
Hallelujah.
So you have to understand how the enemy's attacking you. He's trying to not just erode, he's trying to erode your faith. Because if he can erode your faith, he understands now, I've taken your faith, and now you have no belief. And so then, I can do anything I want to with you. It's kind of like, and guys know this, if you know when you're trying to court or entertain a woman, you really, oftentimes, are trying to get her to change her focus and her belief. And you're trying to get her to put it in you. And the minute you can get her to do that, and the more you can get her to do that, you understand that all the other guys or the enemies that are attacking around you, they have less chance. And so the enemy's no different. So he knows if he can attack you and get you focused on him and get you off the word of God, he knows that your little 2 hours on Sunday, even if you go, it ain't gonna have no effect.
No effect. Come on.
It ain't gonna have no effect. So he understands, he knows that. That's why he tries to attack us in that way. But the only way you know that is you have to read and know this word of God. So we have to understand what's going on. So many people, they'll say, I don't have time to read the word of God. I don't have time to listen. But I don't know too many people when they drive around in our cars, we say, I don't have time to stop and get gas. Because we understand the alternative to stopping and get gas is we're walking. And so I don't know about you, but walking is not something that I want to do, quite honestly, very much, unless I'm exercising. But I can't imagine having to walk to work or walk to the store. But what we're saying oftentimes is that's what we believe in our faith walk. We're saying that I don't have time. I don't have time to open this word. I don't have time to go to church. But then when we out, when we down on our luck and we busted and disgusted and we walking, we kind of like, well, how did we get here? I can tell you how you got there. You didn't stop and get any gas. You didn't stop and get any fuel. So your faith is zero. Your belief, zero. So you're walking on your own power. And the Bible tells us that our power ain't gonna do it. But that's oftentimes how we are out here, and many people are out here fighting this battle daily on their own power.
Amen.
On their own power. And they're wondering why life is just crumbling around you. Whole life, family, everything falling apart around you. You can't control this thing on your own.
Only God.
You have to understand where your source. You gotta get some fuel. So, last question we gotta ask ourselves at least is, well, what is the importance of faith? And simply, faith is the basic fundamental root of Christianity. Mm-hmm. It's the fundamental root. Now, we're going to talk about grace, because you can't really talk about grace or faith and not talk about grace, because we got to understand that. But when you start talking about the fundamental root, our connection to God is our faith. So that's why it's so important. The importance of faith cannot be stressed enough. It can't be stressed enough, because we understand that it's easier to believe in something that we see because it requires very little. I won't say zero of it, but it requires very little. It requires very little. We talk about it oftentimes. When you sit in a chair, nobody inspects chairs when they sit down there. Nobody looks under the chair, gets out the specs to see if it can hold 300. Nobody, they just sit down with the understanding, because they've seen it work in the past, that chair is going to hold me. So they are operating on some level of faith. They have some level of faith. Now, it might not be a huge level, but they have some level of faith because they have not sat down in that chair to know if it really will hold them or not. But I don't see people walking around inspecting chairs when they sit down. They just sit down because they've seen it work in the past. Faith is the most powerful element that connects and holds us to God.
Amen.
In such a manner that it goes far beyond human comprehension. We don't quite understand faith. Faith scares us, but if you want to be connected to God, the only thing that connects us, you have to start with faith.
Amen.
You have to start there.
Believe.
You have to start there. That's fun. He requires it. And I'm gonna show you in the scripture where he says as much. Our faith in God is the very thing that holds us steady and keeps us from the terrifying storms of life. When you got stuff going on and you don't understand, I honestly don't, I think about this often, I can't imagine being in this world and having my only thing I could depend on was me. I can't imagine that I would have to figure, I mean, I'm talking about when your family ain't working, things ain't going right at the job, things ain't even going right in your own mind, because you can get there. And the only thing I could stand and have, the only thing I could believe in was me. I can't imagine what that life would be like. I can't even imagine what that has to be like. I can't imagine how terrifying that must be. So when people say, well, I don't understand how someone gets to the point of suicide, I could see it. Mm-hmm. If the only thing I had to depend on was me, and that's all I had, that's the only thing I thought I had, I can easily see, I can give up on me easy. Mm-hmm. I can give up on me real quick, because that ain't a whole lot. But our faith, that's why God gives it to us, and that's why he wants us to keep fueling, because he tells us, you are in a battle for your soul.
Amen.
So if you don't have some fuel to fight off all the everything that's coming at you, everything gonna be thrown at you. Boy, you're gonna be fighting. You ain't gonna be fighting no much. You're gonna be bringing a knife to a gunfight, mm-hmm. and you ain't gonna get close enough to stab nothing, and two, you can't even shield protect. You can't do anything. You just out there swinging, but you having a little effect because there's people shooting, and so it talks about that. It's fiery darts coming.
Come on now.
And you out there trying to stab something. There's somebody shooting at you 200-300 yards away, and you trying to stab them. It just can't work. So you have to be very careful. It's the essential base of our reliance and confidence in God. And then moreover, faith is the element by which we get access to the many mind-blowing blessings of God. So how do I know I'm the head and not the tail? How do I? Because it's my faith. Because obviously, sometimes in life, you look around and you say, well, God, you say I'm not the head and not the tail, but see right now, it's like I'm at the bottom of the barrel.
That's right. But you said it. Come on now.
But I have to have some faith and belief in the Word of God. And so I think about what just happened here some weeks ago now. It's been about 5 weeks since the election, 4 weeks, a month or whatever. And I love social media, but I don't get on social media and get on it as much as I used to. But I do still, I'm on it. And it was interesting to me to see how the body of Christ will respond into the election. I heard you had some people in the body of Christ saying, now we need to pray. Okay. Well, one, I don't know that we should have stopped praying before.
Right.
So I don't know why we want to start now. I don't know why this makes us want to think we need to start praying. And then there was another group of in the body of Christ that said, well, we understand God is in control. God wanted this, so we should be okay with it. And honestly, what they really are saying is, well, the world is coming to an end. This is gonna kind of speed it along. His coming back. So they were like, well, we should be thankful. We're gonna go with it. So I'm like, well, but this is people in the body of Christ. Now I'm telling you, these are people that they are faithful and they are believers. But they almost sometimes, and we're gonna talk about this in a few weeks, where they speak with a false tongue. Because at one point you're saying we're going to pray to God, but then when things don't go the way we thought they should have gone, then we're saying, well, maybe we either need to pray more, or maybe we've prayed the wrong prayer, or maybe he didn't hear us. And that's the way we are with God sometimes. We pray, but then we don't really, we praying, so we faithful in our prayer, but we don't believe God. So if our situation don't turn out exactly the way we thought it should, we believe God must have made a mistake. We believe God didn't hear. We believe God he missed it on this one. But that's not the way God works. And so I want to make sure that faith must be expressed on the ground of what God has already done. And so you say, well, I understand my faith is struggling. So you say my faith is struggling. And so I need something. I need a little something. I need a little more belief. I need a little more fact. Well, that's the other reason you need to be reading and hearing the Word of God. Because the more you hear about what God has already done, see, now when I say, people say, well, okay, I understand that was the children of Israel. He brought them from that captive. Well, understand that your Red Sea might not necessarily be the Red Sea that they crossed, but you got some things in your life that you need to get a hurdle over. Or you have some things in your life that you're trying to get a break from. And so when you start to read their story, you start to understand that story is not just the children of Israel, but God can do the same thing in your life. God.
Come on now.
So you start to now have some, okay, God,
hallelujah.
You've already done this. So now, I'm not saying God's still not going to require some faith.
Right.
But now if you're one of those people that maybe you say, well, God, I'm going to need a little bit of belief in this thing. He gives you examples of him already doing it. He gives you your 2 + 2 = 4. So God, how do I know that you can bring me out of this situation? because I read and I heard it that you've done it in the past.
Amen.
And you said what you've done for the least of them, you've done it. So God, if you've done it for them, you'll do it for me.
Amen.
And so that's why we have to understand and know when we are with our faith walk, God not only, you have to understand, and I think sometimes we miss this. God is not as, he's not as standoffish as we think he is.
Oh my goodness. Thank you, Lord.
And so God knows. God knows that how we think. Mm-hmm. He made us.
Yes.
So he understands and knows sometimes we fall off. Mm-hmm. Sometimes, God, I'm trying to be faithful here, but God, I need you to show me something. I need you to do something to give me some belief in this thing, because I need to see it. And so God, he gave us a book of, hey, I've done this. I've used people like you. I've done it. He gives you something to believe in because you know it has happened. So let's talk about 16 things of why faith is important. Let's go with the first one. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. And if this, I won't say this is the most important one, but it's got to be, it's got to be pretty high on the list. Listen to what he says here in Hebrews chapter 11. Somebody read Hebrews chapter 11. I'm sorry, I'll read it. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. Here's what it says. It says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him.
Mm-hmm.
For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. So you say, well, why is faith important? If God says it's impossible, impossible to please God if you don't have faith. Impossible. It says it's impossible to please him. But then he goes on and he says, you got to have faith. It's impossible to please him without faith. But then look what he said there. He says, for it is impossible to please him, for he who comes to God, he says, must believe. Must believe.
Must.
He said, you must believe that he is the rewarder of those that diligently seek him. So you say, okay, God, I got to pray. I'm praying, God. But he didn't stop right there. And I think oftentimes people say, well, whatever you ask God, he's going, no, he said, listen to what the scripture said. He said, you must believe. Because he says, if you don't believe that I am a rewarder of those that diligently seek him, that faith, it ain't going to work that way with him. So God, it ain't going to work. I don't care how you try to do it. You have to not only have faith in God, but God requires that you believe in him. And so the first thing you got to know, it's impossible to please God unless you have faith. Impossible.
Impossible.
He says it's impossible. Go to Genesis chapter 15, verse 6. And we're gonna, the second thing God says here is, it says to be accounted or reckoned as righteous. He said in order to be righteous, listen to what he says in Genesis 15. Genesis 15, he says, verse 6, he says something here that he says, listen to what he says. He says, and he believed in the Lord, and he accounted it to him for righteousness. So he says he believed. He had faith in the Lord, and he says, and he accounted it to him for righteousness. So understand that faith is required for righteousness. Mm-hmm. And we understand that we want to be righteous.
Mm-hmm.
And so God says, if you want to be righteous, you got to have faith. Mm-hmm. Go to Romans 4 really quick here. And we won't read all of these for the sake of time, but I'll give you all 16 of them. Romans chapter 4, verse 23. Romans chapter 4, verse 23 through 25 reads on this wise. It says, now it was written for his sake alone that it was imputed on him, or to him, but also for us. It shall be imputed to us who believe in him, who raised up Jesus, our Lord, from the dead, who was delivered up because of our offenses and was raised because of our justification. Understand that faith is how also required for our righteousness. You have to have faith in knowing that Jesus went to the cross for your offenses. You weren't there. I wasn't there. But I have faith in knowing that Jesus hung on the cross for me. Mm-hmm. Third thing, in order to be a son of God, you must have faith. Go to Galatians chapter 3, verse 6. Galatians chapter 3, verse 6 through 9 reads on this wise. It says, just as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, therefore know that only those who are of faith are sons of Abraham. And the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith preached the gospel to Abraham beforehand, saying, in you all nations shall be blessed. Verse 9. So then those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham. Amen. So if you want to call yourself a son of God or a child of God, I didn't say it. Scriptures say you have to have faith. Mm-hmm. Have to have faith. Some people might find this one important. Stay in Galatians, go to verse 11. In order, the importance of faith is this. Read chapter 3, verse 11. We're already there. Listen to this. It says, but that no one is justified by the law in the sight of God is evident. For the just shall live by faith. If you want to live forever, you got to have faith. Because you have to, in order to understand, if you want to live forever, you have to be justified. And in order to be justified, I didn't say it, the word says you have to have faith. You have to have faith in God. It's a requirement. It's God's requirement. I won't read this one for the sake of time. I'll read it right now. If you go to Romans chapter 5, this is what it says about faith. Justification is by faith. If we want to be justified, it says we have to have faith. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Being justified. For our prayers to be answered. The sixth thing. If you want your prayers answered, gotta have faith. Go to Mark chapter 11, verse 20. Mark chapter 11, verse 24, I believe. Mark 11, 22, I'm sorry, 22 through 24. It says, so Jesus answered and said to them, have faith in God. For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Therefore I say unto you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. So if you say, well, why is faith important? Jesus says here that when you pray and you have to have some belief and you have to have faith, your prayers are answered. Number 7, it's not to flatter God. And I think sometimes here, let's read this one, Psalms chapter 5, or the book of Psalms 5, fifth book of Psalms. Let's go to verse 9 here, see what the psalmist writes. And we'll talk about it briefly. Book 5 of Psalms, verse 9. For there is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is destruction. Their throat is an open tomb. They flatter with their tongue. If you have no faith, you're merely impressing other people. It's merely flattery because, as the psalmist writes here, you're speaking death. When you open your mouth, because you have no faith, you don't believe in what you're saying, you might as well be speaking death. And it's mere flattery. It's mere flattery, but he says there it's an open tomb. It has no worth. 8 is to receive promises. And I won't go to the book, but you can find to receive promises, Romans chapter 4, verse 16. It talks about if you want to receive the promises of God. And it talks about Abraham, and the reason he received the promises of God was by his faith. And so if we want to receive the promises of God, we must have faith.
Amen.
Number 9, to be hopeful, you must have faith. Mm-hmm. Go to Romans chapter 4, verse 18. Quickly, Romans chapter 4, I think this was important. If you want to have some hope, living in a world right now where many don't have hope. Romans chapter 4, verse 18. Who contrary to hope, in hope believed, so that he became the father of many nations, according to what was spoken. So shall your descendants be. And not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body already dead, since he was about 100 years old, and the deadness of Sarah's womb. And what we're talking about here is Abraham, his faith is what allowed him to be father of many nations. When we talk about the father of the faith, we talk about Abraham. Understand, it was great faith that was required, because for all intents and purposes, he was a 100-year-old man with an old wife, and he's talking about now having a child. But it was his faith that made him overcome that situation or see that situation through. Number 10, to walk in the light of this world. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. For we walk by faith, not by sight. If the only thing, we talked about it before, if the only thing that gets you to move in God is what you see, you're not going to move in God long. Because he does not necessarily work that way. Because no faith is required. Now listen to this, Ephesians. Go to Ephesians chapter 6. We were talking about taking a knife to a gunfight. Listen what it says about faith in Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 6. We have to understand that faith is vital. We talk about it's our root. We gotta have it. And if we don't have it or we take it for granted, when we get out here and we start getting into the battles and we start stumbling and trembling along, if we don't have faith, we will be defeated. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 16 says this, above all, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked one. How you gonna fight off when you got everything, when everything coming apart? You gotta have faith. That's the only way you're going to fight it off. He says faith is our shield. So if you don't have faith, you have no protection from what the enemy will do to you. Now, we got to read this one, because we're going to be talking about this next week. We're talking about repentance next week. But we had to talk about faith first, because in order to even ask for repentance, you have to have some faith. So go to Mark chapter 10. And it says this. I'm sorry, Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2, verse 5. I'm flipping quickly. It says this. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the quadriplegic at this point, "The son, your sins are forgiven." The 12th thing is, in order for your sins to be forgiven, you got to have faith. You have to have some faith. 13, to enter and inherit the kingdom of heaven. Mark chapter 10, verse 15 says that. Let's flip over. Mark chapter 10, verse 15. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it. You have to have some faith in God. And when it says, assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, understand that Jesus is talking here in this parable. He's talking to the people. And I think that's where we are here in the world today. We have taken children more and more, and vast numbers are not even ever exposed to God. And God and Jesus talks about here, and he knows this. We talk about this oftentimes. The more you experience life, the more you know, the more you think you know. And if you don't have if you don't come to God at an early state, it's hard. The longer and longer you go without understanding, appreciating, having some knowledge of God, it becomes a little harder. And so understand that it almost becomes, in order to enter and inherit the kingdom of heaven, surely I say to you, anyone that does not have their kind of faith, a child, oftentimes, you think about a child's faith, child at an early age, they don't know it. That's all they know. And honestly, oftentimes, children, the beautiful thing about children, oftentimes, they'll give their faith pretty freely. They just assume people are going to do good. And so you have to have that order, because you have to inherit the kingdom of God. You have to have some faith. And the longer and longer you stay disconnected away from God, though, the harder it is to really lean on faith, though, because you start to question everything. The source of peace and joy in life. This can be found in Romans chapter 5, verse 1. But for the sake of time, I won't go there. But that's the 14th thing. It's the source of peace and joy. The source of protection. 1 Thessalonians 5 and 8. But let us know who live in the light, think clearly, protected by the body armor of faith, love, and wearing our helmet, the confidence of our salvation. And the number 16, assurance of salvation. Let's turn to it. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 39. Hebrews chapter 10, 39. Says this, but we are not those who draw back our perdition, but of those who believe to the saving of our soul. You have to have faith, because that assures your salvation. Now, I want to talk quickly here, but we have to understand, and I'm going to synopsize here because it's time to close, but understand that without God's grace, you could not even have access to faith. So, and that's why I say I can't leave without talking about God's grace. God loves us so much that he gave us an access to faith by his grace. Because when man sinned, he created faith so that we would have an ability, an access back. So, and you say, I'm not saying that Christ wasn't our access back. He was the sacrifice.
Yes, he was.
He was the sacrifice. But faith, because we have to have faith in Christ.
Yes.
That's what gives us now that access. So he had to give us faith in order to give us the sacrifice, in order to allow faith to now have us believe in the sacrifice and believe in Jesus Christ that we might come back. There's another powerful bond between faith and grace. The reason that God's grace is the starting point of faith, it's the substance that makes faith necessary. Without grace, there cannot be faith. If God would have let man fall and had no grace upon him, you wouldn't know anything about faith. You wouldn't know anything about having faith in anything. But he allowed us, his grace towards us.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
He opened up, he allowed faith so that you might have now access to him. So now see, grace implies receiving unmerited favor of God. It's unmerited favor. He gave us faith. We don't deserve it, but he gave us an access back to him through faith. He gave us something to have faith in. God's willingness to make himself available to us is predicated upon his grace, since we don't deserve it. And his grace is the channel through which his blessings flow. However, we can only respond to him through the means of our faith. He's given us faith. How do we know we're appreciated? How does he know we're appreciated? Because we put faith back into him. That's how we know. And in closing, we got to understand, he took the first step for us.
Thank you, Lord.
He took the first step. God did an awesome thing when he brought humanity into this earth in the form of Jesus Christ to die on that cross.
Yes, he did. Thank you, Lord.
Because he understood that we're going to have a problem with faith. Mm-hmm. He says, let me take the first step.
Jesus, thank you, Lord.
Let me give you a savior. Let me let my son be the sacrifice. Because let me take the first step and give you something. I'm going to show you. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give you Jesus Christ to die for your sins. Now all I'm asking, believe it.
Believe that. Come on now.
That's all I'm asking. Mm-hmm. But he didn't ask us to believe in something that he did. He brought Jesus Christ. So you say, well, God, I'm struggling. I'm telling you, God, I'm telling you, he'll talk to you. He understands us. You say, God, I'm struggling. I understand. I read these words, but I've seen no Savior. So he says, okay, let me give you a Savior. Let me give you Jesus Christ to come to this earth, to be crucified, dead, and buried, and to resurrect himself, so that now you have something to put your faith into.
Yes.
He put a man on this earth to walk around on this earth to say, oh, that Jesus now, I can put faith in you, God, because now, you know, also, God, I didn't see Jesus. I wasn't there when he hung on the cross.
Come on now.
But my faith, and I got some word here, and I'm putting my faith and belief in the word of God, that you have taken the first step to give me access to you in the form of faith. So in closing this morning, I say, where is your faith? Where is your faith?
Amen.
Faith is going to be required here in the days to come.
Oh my God, yes, Deke. Yes.
You better know where your faith is. You better know where your faith comes from. You better know the importance of your faith. And you better know why it's important, when it's important, and you better know that there is a difference between faith and belief.
Yes.
And the true believers of Christ, those in the body of Christ, we can't merely just have faith, but we got to have belief in this thing we're standing on.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Y'all have a blessed day.
Yes, Lord.